Going to bring in the Prime Minister now. It is Tuesday morning. She joins us at this time every Monday or Tuesday. Lots to talk about this morning. Quarantining and returning Kiwis and the cost of it. China and our relationship with them. But first, let's start with Andrew Falloon. Morning, Prime Minister. Nice to have you with us. Can you talk us through the timetable of when you found out about Andrew Falloon and how the decision was made to pass it on to the Leader of the Opposition?
Sure. My understanding is that we received the correspondence on Wednesday. By the time it came up through our system, it was kept fairly tightly managed, wanting to respect the confidentiality and privacy of the individual that had written. That I was called and told about it on, I believe, Friday morning. My immediate response was, and I was given general details, not the name of the MP and certainly not the name of the complainant. My view was that ultimately it needed to be dealt with by the person who had the ability to deal with it, and that would essentially be the leader of that MP's political party. I asked that the complainant was, that the permission was sought for it to be shared. That happened, and then the correspondence was passed on Friday. And that, as far as I'm concerned, was the end of our involvement.
Given it was a National Party MP, and given that the person who received this unsolicited and very much unwanted message from Andrew Falloon knew that he was a National Party MP, why did they come to your office? Was there any explanation of why they came to you?
I can't tell you necessarily why they decided to come to us, but that doesn't surprise me, John, and I don't want
to suggest there's political motivations here, because there is no evidence of that whatsoever, and Andrew Falloon is completely out of order sending this. But I guess,
if you let me just finish, I can give you my assessment of why they might have. When people feel that they haven't got an outcome that they wanted, particularly if they've used authorities, then often the place of last resort people often see as being me in my office, and I totally understand that. I can only assume that might have been the motivation in that case. But regardless, my judgment was that the best person to be able to deal with the issue was the person who had direct responsibility for that Member of Parliament. Had it been a member of my own team, then it would have rested with me. But what was very important to me was that, of course, it was not used in any political way whatsoever. It was kept very tightly managed, confidential, and was shared directly with the Leader of the Opposition, which I felt was the most appropriate thing to do.
What would you have done if it was a member of your team?
I would have sat down with them, talked through exactly what had happened, and my expectation under what I've heard has happened in this case would be that they'd no longer be a member of Parliament.
Do you know what the image was?
No. And look, when I had the conversation with my team about what had happened in these circumstances, you know, I wanted to make sure that, again, that it was kept fairly tight. I didn't want to know the name of the Member of Parliament involved or the person complaining. Those details weren't shared with me. For me, it was all about knowing general circumstances and determining what was most appropriate in the way that it was dealt with.
Right. Yesterday, when this came out, Andrew Falloon made a statement which I'm confused about. He talks about mental health, and I'm confused about when the mental health issues arose. We asked Judith Collins this morning, and she had no evidence of him having mental health issues prior to this event, and he certainly hadn't spoken to the party's whips about needing any assistance. But I guess, how the hell do we manage a culture of robustness, a culture of arrogance, a culture of hubris, a culture of abusive position, which we have seen a large number of episodes of lately? How the hell do we get parliamentarians to behave themselves?
No, I was asked this question in general terms yesterday, John, and I'll say the same thing that I said then. You know, when I took over as leader of the Labor Party, I was very deliberate in saying that no matter what else was happening in politics, that I was absolutely determined that we within our team would try and change the culture of politics, that we would campaign positively, that we wouldn't involve ourselves in personal politicking or in what people often call dirty politics. That in my mind, if we wanted to restore people's faith in political institutions, if we wanted a strong democracy, we need people to look to this place and to the politicians and parties within it and have a bit of faith in us. So we can do our bit, each as political leaders, to try and change those cultures. And so I will take responsibility for that with my team and as much as I can for trying to set a tone. But we all have a role to play in that.
Let's segue, and it's a weird kind of segue, but in terms of setting the tone, I wonder if the $3,000 charge that you were talking about on returning New Zealanders is less about tone. Well, it's a populist tone, isn't it? There is a sense that people are frustrated and angered. There's 1.5 million New Zealanders roughly living abroad. There is a massive diaspora. Some of them are going to find themselves in brutally tough circumstances. They're going to return home, be put in isolation against their will and now charged for it.
Well, no, actually, we haven't made a decision on that, John, so sorry if I was interrupting you. I just wanted to add that caveat. You know, the reason that we, in fact, you know, look, Australia is now charging everyone coming back to Australia. The Leader of the Opposition over the weekend chucked out a view that they believe they want to charge.
And Megan Wood said, hey, that's our policy. We're pleased the Nats like it.
We are working through what is a very complex situation. As you say, there are some people in tough circumstances. Equally, we have legal obligations to make sure that New Zealanders are able to return home, and whether or not this would be then seen as an impediment to that. On the flip side of that, you know, we are spending the better part of over $300 million on quarantining. And so there are a range of things that we need to factor in. We haven't made that final decision, but we are considering all of those really critical elements. It is not a straightforward decision.
What does the Bill of Rights tell us about the right of New Zealanders to be able to return home?
And this is why actually there are some legal ramifications that need to be worked through and given full consideration, because people do have for those who have said, for instance, that we should close our borders entirely, New Zealand citizens, they have a right to come back to the place that they are legally able to reside. One of the things I have though said, John, is that, you know, there may be an argument to treat differently those who are returning versus those who are safely within New Zealand right now, but for whatever reason choose to leave and then return.
Everyone will be nodding in agreement. Do you have any idea how many people there are in the latter category? I mean, if you're using that,
a much smaller number.
Yeah.
Yeah, but okay. Equally, we do want New Zealanders to think that decision through, because that is not something they should take lightly when it comes at a cost to everyone.
Can we talk about China? You talked yesterday about our principal concerns, and we look at Dominic Raab severing the extradition treaty with Hong Kong overnight in a protest against the draconian new laws that mainland China is implementing in Hong Kong. Are we looking at doing something similar with our extradition treaty with Hong Kong?
Yep.
Are we standing up strongly enough against the cynicism of the CCP at the moment?
Well, obviously, we have made our views on what has happened within Hong Kong plainly known. We have, in light of what's happened with the new national security legislation, asked the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and Trade, the minister has, to review all of our current legal arrangements in light of that change in legislation. And so that's work that is underway as we speak. In the meantime, what I would say is that New Zealand would not extradite anyone for something that is not considered illegal in New Zealand. So the right to hold political views and political expression is an example of that. But we are also looking at all of our legal arrangements as well.
Prime Minister Jacinda Ardern, thank you so much for joining us this morning. We appreciate your time, as we always do.
Thanks for yours.